See inside your eye with that same eye, part one. Here is a list of six techniques scientists have described for seeing inside your eye with that same eye. The oldest technique, which is the topic of this video, involves using a point light source to see clear shadows of floaters in your eye and any spots you might have in the lens of your eye. In this video, I will demonstrate a number of ways to do this while reviewing the history and explaining some of the science. I will also show numerous examples of what you might see in your own eyes. The other techniques allow you to see blood moving in capillaries on the retina, shadows of the blood vessels on the retina, nerve activity on the retina, and the back of the eye. I hope to cover these other techniques in future videos. But let's get back to the topic of this video, the first and oldest technique for seeing inside your own eye with that same eye, starting with a little science history. The German astronomer Johannes Kepler published a book on optics in 1604 in which he stated that our eyes function by focusing an image onto the back of the eye. The physicist and astronomer Christoph Scheiner proved Kepler was right by removing most of the tissue from the back of actual eyes and looking at the focused images. Then, in 1674, the French mathematician Claude-François Deschalet described how a nearsighted person or someone holding a magnifying lens in front of their eye can see the shadows of defects in the eye in the unfocused image of a distant light source. It was later discovered that looking at a brightly lit surface through a pinhole in a card held close to the eye served the same purpose, as well as other lens arrangements and looking closely at the reflection of a distant light in a tiny drop of mercury on black felt. Let me explain how these various methods work and also demonstrate these and some other variations. Light rays from a sufficiently distant and small source arrive at the eye almost parallel. The light can be a candle like Deschalet used, or something like a AAA mini mag light in candle mode, which I prefer to use. The cornea and lens of the eye refract this light to focus it to a point on the retina. But in a nearsighted person, this light will be focused to a point in front of the retina, then it will spread out on the retina. It will appear as a disc because its shape is determined by the shape of the opening in the iris, which is round in humans. Holding a magnifying lens in front of your eye will do the same thing. Not only does the border of the iris cast a shadow, but so does whatever might be in the path of the light, like a dark spot in the lens of the eye. You can also use a concave lens, perhaps one salvaged from the viewfinder of a junk camera, to create an unfocused image of a distant light on your retina. Or you can cancel out the focusing effect of the cornea by filling a swim goggle with saline solution. Finally, you can use a tiny, shiny, convex surface, like a small drop of mercury on black felt or the tines of a fork held to reflect light. What you are actually doing is creating a virtual image of the distant light. This image is functionally the same as a tiny light source held too close to your eye for you to focus on. You can also create a real image using a magnifying lens. However, using a mirror or lens has the disadvantage that you will see any imperfections in the mirror or lens as shadows, along with the shadows of things on or in your eye. The best thing to do is to simply create a point source of light that can be held close to your eye. One of the easiest ways to do this is to crumple up some aluminum foil, then flatten it out. Put this over a flashlight and you will notice numerous tiny holes. Put a piece of matte finish cellophane tape over some of the holes to diffuse the light, then hold the light close to your eye. The smallest holes will make the clearest shadows, but they will also be dimmer. If you don't have a flashlight handy, you can hold the foil close to your eye and face a bright light. If you don't have matte finish cellophane tape, instead of facing a light, just face a brightly lit white surface like a blank computer screen, a white wall, or the daytime sky. Remember, the disc of light you see is defined by the shadow of your iris and not by the shape of the hole or the light itself. The disc will get bigger as you move the light closer and smaller as you move it farther away. The first things you may notice in the disc of light you see are the shadows of your eyelashes and an eyelid moving as you blink. You might also notice shadows of tear films and bubbles on the surface of your eye. Blink slowly and you will see your eyelid close off the disc of light. Use a finger to keep one eyelid from moving and you will see that the shadow is upside down. If the top eyelid is moving, the shadow will appear from the bottom and vice versa. Squint and notice that you can make a tear film. If you squint so that your eyelids meet in the center of the cornea, you can actually make a ridge in the cornea that, unlike the tear film, will not immediately go away with blinking. Press gently on the cornea through your closed eyelid, then quickly open your eye and look at the point light source, and you should see a mosaic of wrinkles. If you move your head from side to side or up and down while holding the light steady, you should see shadows of things floating back and forth in your eye. These are commonly called vitreous floaters or just floaters. The Latin name for them is muscae volitantes. Many people are already familiar with floaters because large floaters, or floaters which are very close to the retina, can be seen without any special device, particularly when looking at a bright uniform surface which causes the pupil to constrict. The Swiss ophthalmologist and researcher Hans Goldmann explained in a lecture in 1960 how the vitreous humor in the eye changes over time, resulting in floaters. Floaters may also be remnants of embryonic tissue or individual red blood cells which seep into the vitreous and swell up due to osmotic pressure. Diffraction patterns, including Poisson spot, can be seen around floaters. Floaters can be seen particularly well if you view them with monochromatic light. By moving the point light source from side to side, you will be able to get an idea of the relative location of various floaters. The shadows of the floaters closest to the retina will move the least, while shadows of things further away will move more. Now let's look at the lens. The lens starts out as living tissue made up of layers of long cells which die over time, resulting in a loss of flexibility and clarity. The arrangement of the cells results in radial lines sometimes being seen. The lens can contain imperfections inside it and associated with it. The following drawings show a variety of shadows associated with the lens. Perhaps the lenses in your eyes match some of these features. These drawings were published by the German mathematician and physicist Johann Benedict Listing in 1845 and represent the left and right eyes of a number of different people. By the way, Listing was the first to use the word entoptic to mean things you see within your own eye. So what about practical medical benefits to seeing inside your own eye? In 1847, the Dutch ophthalmologist Franciscus Cornelis Donders wrote a detailed essay on the use of entoptic investigation in the diagnosis of defects of the eye. But then, in 1864, he wrote, "Now that, thanks to the valuable invention of Helmholtz, the ophthalmoscope is in our hands, the importance of the entoptic mode of examination for diagnosis is thrown completely into the shade." In 1867, the French magician and inventor Robert Houdin described a device he made called the iridoscope. The iridoscope consisted of a small cup that was placed over the eye. A 0.1 millimeter hole in the cup served as a point light source. This is the earliest device that was named that I am aware of, and his invention was reported in the British Medical Journal at that time. In 1895, the French doctor Armand Darrier wrote about an arrangement of a distant candle and a concave lens held in front of the eye, which he called an autofacoscope. By means of this simple and ingenious method, a clever observer can easily follow the development of a cataract in his own lens, he wrote. And he showed how a developing cataract might look. In 1906, Sir William Fletcher Barrett, an English physicist and parapsychologist, wrote that it was the discovery of a small permanent obscurity in both of my eyes before any opacity was detected by the ophthalmoscope that led me to devise the entoptoscope, an instrument that allowed a person to easily draw what they saw while looking at a point light source. He added, "I have found the periodic examination of my own eyes a matter of considerable, if not exhilarating, interest, inasmuch as the slow progress of the cataract and the curious way in which it spreads can be watched up to the inevitable end." But you don't need an iridoscope, an autofocoscope, or an optoscope to track cataract growth. These three drawings were made in 1915, 1919, and 1922 by a patient using a pinhole in a black card held between the window and the eye. In 1975, Wolf-Dieter Berndt obtained a patent for an inexpensive handheld device to permit a patient to perform a self-examination of the eye and thereby determine if he should seek professional help. His invention starts out like an ordinary flashlight with batteries and bulb, but has a short length of fiber optic to create a point source of light and a rubber cup that is put next to the eye. In his application, he claims it is possible for the observer to detect physiological changes such as cataracts. Edmund Scientific marketed his device as an eyescope, but didn't really promote any medical benefits. Now I have come full circle because this particular technique of seeing inside your own eye started out as just an interesting phenomenon, was investigated and promoted for potential medical benefits, and now is considered to be of little practical value. Full circle also because it was my chance discovery of a broken eyescope which led me to delve into the whole field of entoptics and beyond. For more information on this and other methods of seeing entoptically, see my article in the American Biology Teacher, check out the following references, and check for future videos. Please click on like and subscribe.